My huge problem for today is surgery. So we all know surgery. Most of us will undergo surgery at least once. They save a lot of lives. They improve the quality of many other lives. But the way we do surgeries today is very far from ideal. So just to think of it, they're very, very expensive. Training the staff, building the operation theater, maintaining both is a huge financial burden. And that leads to the fact that most people on the planet who need surgery don't have access to those facilities and those and that personnel. Just to give you some numbers, this year in the US alone, more than 50 million inpatient surgeries will be performed. These surgeries will cost between $25 and $150 per minute in the OR, not counting procedure-specific costs. And between 1% and 3% of the patients will die within 30 days of the procedure from complications. What I'd like to do here is to propose to you an alternative approach which could revolutionize the entire field as it looks today. So imagine that we could take all the facilities, all the equipment, all the knowledge required to perform a successful surgery and encode it in a single drop of saline. So that drop can be put inside a syringe. You can take it anywhere on Earth. You can give it to anyone in need without even having to anesthetize them first. Inside the patient, the drop inside the syringe will find its target, will remove the cells, kill them, locate them from A to B, recruit new cells to fix that tissue, and have the computation capacity of a real computer. So how can this be done? It sounds a bit far-fetched, but let me explain to you how we can already do that, and I hope it will be enabled in the very near future. So if you could look inside that drop of saline, magnified by about 70,000, you will see billions and billions of tiny objects. Each of these objects that you see here is a robot with chassis and moving parts, a robot that can be programmed to do amazing things. These robots are built from DNA. We use a technique known as DNA origami to take a piece of DNA and fold it into the 3D structure that comprises the robot, the machine. These robots were born about 4 years ago in a work I did with Sean Douglas at the lab of George Church at Harvard Medical School. So each robot has a very specific task it knows how to do. It picks up a cargo at point A and drops the cargo at point B. Now, in fact, it doesn't actually drop the cargo. It rather switches the cargo from a concealed state to an exposed state. So basically, it switches the cargo from off to on, and it can go back to off, and it can do this repeatedly. In the past 2 years, we learned to design robots that are invisible to the host immune system, to the mammalian immune system. We've learned how to tune their stability in the blood, and now it ranges between several minutes and many, many hours. So it might seem very simple. It might seem very limited in its capabilities, but building on this very basic routine of pick cargo at A, drop cargo at B, we can build an astonishing array of tasks. And what I'd like to do now is to walk together with you through the tasks required to perform successful surgery, and let's see how each of these can be translated into the language the robots understand. So the first thing is that a surgery takes place at a specific interface. That is the interface between the target tissue and a background tissue. Now, a trained surgeon can manually define this interface with a precision of about maybe sub-millimeter. But these robots can do tens of thousands of times better. You can think of them as scalpels, as sharp as a molecule, basically. So by programming robots to identify both target and background tissues, we can have them organizing themselves around that interface. And now they can expose and activate a cargo, which in this case is not a drug. It's an enzyme that can cut tissue components or matrix components, cut the links between cells, disintegrating the tissue cell by cell. The second thing that you have to do, you have to know how to do to make a surgery, is to move cells from A to B. You can either, in the most basic sense, remove a target you remove your target tissue to the trash, in which case the trash is point B, or you can recruit cells from another place to come and fill in the gap and regrow and regenerate the tissue. So that's also moving cells from A to B. The robots know how to do this just like ants do when they carry prey much larger than themselves. They recognize the specific cells, as you can see here. They detach them from their surroundings. Then they can carry specifically those cells, not the other cells. They can carry them from point A to point B based on a combination of molecules defining points A and B, which is how the robots know to differentiate between points A and B. The second thing is once you have the cell, you need to know how to reprogram its biology. You need to tell the cell to either die, or you can, again, recruit cells and tell them to regrow and fix the tissue and regenerate that tissue. So we've already shown in numerous examples, including the one we published 2 years ago, that when we load the robots with cancer drugs, with proteins, with growth factors, we can tell the cells to either suppress their signaling or die eventually, like you see in the upper figure. Or we can also tell cells to grow, as you can see in the example of robots loaded with insulin. So by the way, when the robots grab their cells, and now they can engage those cells with selective signaling molecules, you can have the robots scan your entire system looking for metastatic cells, and finding each of these single metastatic cells, holding them, making sure they don't attach anywhere, but also now acting on them, killing them, making sure no cell remains. So the last thing, in addition to acting on that interface and on those cells, you need to be able to provide support. For example, you want to regulate bleeding to prevent excessive bleeding from that surgery. You want to reduce pain. You want to negate inflammation. There are many things you need to do that are not directly related to that incision you're doing right now. So you already know that these robots can be programmed to carry out all those tasks. I want to show you a specific example of robots that can selectively target and suppress nerve cells that transduce pain signals. Okay, so the way they do that is they look for cells that release above a certain threshold of neurotransmitter. And only that threshold activates a robot, and they expose a calcium channel blocker, which blocks specifically those nerve fibers. So they can suppress pain deriving from peripheral procedures. And eventually, you want to take all those components and to integrate them such that they are performed automatically, just as if a computer would control them, right? I mean, and that can be specific to something happening at the patient inside the patient right now, and not something that's constantly. You should be able to, for example, to stop that procedure whenever an excessive damage is caused. So to do that, we designed robots that can mimic the interactions between components in a computer processor. And these robots that you see here can actually interact with each other. It means from point B to these robots is actually another robot. It's not a tissue. So they can communicate and transfer bits of information, which are also DNA molecules, from a robot to robot. And these can emulate successfully logical operators, that are the basic components of computation, inside living animals. Those inputs that these robots read are molecules from the animal, and the output is written in the form of drugs acting on the target cells. So what we do is we combine those robots, we mix populations of robots such that we can generate more complex computations. So this is an example of a half adder, which receives two input molecules from the patient. And you have two output robots, one representing the carry bit, one representing the sum bit, and they can generate a combination of drugs. And this half adder can be joined to a one-bit adder. And you can scale that up ad infinitum, basically. So what we do here is when this technology enables us to take a very complex truth table, which is basically adapted from an oncology textbook. And that truth table means, for this disease, activate this combination. And what it enables us to do is to take a group of robots, load them with the entire ensemble of drugs, and let the robots decide on themselves, based on what they find in the patient, which combination to activate. Moreover, they can, because they sample constantly the patient's environment, they can know when to switch to another combination if the tumor, for example, develops resistance. So we use logic synthesis to infer the architecture that generates that truth table. And this is an example. So you see a multi-layer structure, and you have a first layer searching for markers, searching for disease-specific markers, in this example, lung cancer. And the first layer receives those markers, generates an output, which is fed also as an input to a second layer. Each layer takes about between 7 to 10 minutes to process. And the error is not that high. It only the error is in the order of the root sum of squares of all the errors of individual robots you add in the system. So eventually, that group knows to produce the exact combination of drugs that an oncologist would also decide to activate. And just to wrap this up, if we know all the physical addresses made by molecules in the patient's body, we can program those robots to target specific points and go to specific locations, produce molecular resolution incisions, and completely revolutionize the entire field of surgery as it looks today. So just imagine, to sum up, just imagine how this could look like using, you know, performing surgery in a drop of saline, how much this would cost, basically nothing. And most importantly, how can this become suddenly available to many, many people who need surgery but can't get it? Thank you very much.